in existence, something about the spectrum, the eigenvalues of the Laplacian, or in more generally, symmetric operators, right? So you have learned about that. And you have learned some basic regularity estimates. So at least for now, you get some objective of this theory. So what you do is that you, in the first few lectures, you saw the notion of Sobolev spaces, right? Then the first natural question would be, why at all are you learning about such spaces, except for its abstraction? So what would be its role in PDE, right? But then you see that these are the spaces, okay, which are appropriate extension of the more familiar spaces that you know, that is the C1 or the C2 spaces, and they are big enough spaces where the functional analysis can be applied, okay? So you enlarge your space, make it big enough so that you guarantee the existence of a solution to your differential equation. But then that solution, a priori, is only in that larger space, right? And it's very hard to visualize such a solution. So of course you have a Sobolev solution, okay? You have a function which belongs to a given Sobolev space. But how good is that solution? So for a theory to be good, at least you should have a more concrete realization of such a solution. And that is the role of regularity theory. So you first enlarge your space. So all I'm trying to say is that, so you have a given space, okay, of say C1, CK functions, which is to say that the first K derivatives exist and are continuous and so on. But in this space, you lack completeness, okay, which is not good for applying functional analysis. So you enlarge your space, look at WKP functions, okay, which are closure of these functions under its appropriate norm. And the norm is dictated by the differential equation, okay? So for instance, if you are studying elliptic PDE of this form, you see that it has a corresponding energy, whatever that means, which is Ax grad u, grad u. And because of uniform ellipticity, this is comparable to grad u squared. When I say something is comparable to the other, it means that they just differ from above and below by some fixed constant, okay? So whenever I say something is comparable, I will always indicate it by 1. But it does not mean it would be 1, okay? So I would never be precise about my constants in this whole discussion. Okay, so you see that once you have this, so for the solution space, you need twice integrability of the first derivative, right? So the natural space to consider would be spaces where such functions are integrable, which is to say that you look at W12 spaces. And I guess Professor Sandeep would have used the same notation, right? Maybe H1. Okay? So, you find a solution in such a space, okay? And there are several methods. Either you use the Lax-Milgram theorem, okay, or you can also use direct methods in calculus of variation and so on, okay? And also you have for nonlinear PDEs, the mountain pass theorem. So that probably Professor Adimurthy wouldn't have taught. So he would have mentioned the Lax-Milgram theorem, right? Okay, good. So anyway, so there are many ways of solving this problem. But once you solve this problem, it does not mean that there is necessarily a physical realization of the solution, right? It is an abstract space, Sobolev space. So how good is that function? And that's where, so you find a solution. So the, what should I say? So the strategy, I mean, this is even a wrong word, but I'm groping to find some good words, okay, in this context. So the strategy is that, have strategy in, say, elliptic theory. Have good enough Banach or Hilbert space, okay, where existence is guaranteed, okay, and we will see instances where you can also guarantee want to understand whether the solution is nicer than just any randomly picked solve of function, right? So there comes the rule of regularity. That is, suppose. So then comes the rule of regularity. So which roughly says that if you, in some WKP, which is your one-hour space, is a solution. So let me not be too general, okay? If U in H1 is a solution to some PDE divergence AX, grad U equals to 0 and U equals to G on the boundary, okay? Then the question is, does there exist V nice enough such that V is equal to U almost everywhere? I mean, of course, you have to make sense of this in this manner, right? Because function in an LP space is just an equivalence class. So you just want to find one function in that equivalence class, or does it have, or said differently, for this solution, does it have a smooth representative? Okay? So this is the purpose of regularity theory, where you need to introspect what that PDE tells you. Again, at this point, these are vague words, but soon I will try to clarify what they mean. Okay? So these are two very important aspects. Again, there are many other important aspects in elliptic PDE and in general in PDE, but I would just be able to talk about this because this is, I can only say to the extent I know, right? So my lectures would be on elliptic PDE, but I might not be able to do justice to it. So what I will try to convey is what ellipticity tells you. What ellipticity tells you about the curvatures of the graph of the solution, okay? And the whole, and all these five lectures will build on such scheme of ideas. So even if you have not understood anything in what I have said so far, it's okay. Because soon each of these aspects will be elaborated, okay? In a more organized way. So what is an example of an elliptic PDE that you know? It is a Laplacian, right? And more generally, in Professor Adimurthy's lectures, you have come across variable coefficient elliptic PDEs, which are of the form Aij. So I have to fix some notations, okay? So given a function f, when I write fi, it will mean f of xi. When I write fij, it will mean f of xi, xj. Except when I indicate the coefficients of the principal part. Okay, so there will be a point of difference over here. So when you write aij, uij equals to 0, this is the same thing as saying summation I over j equals to 1 to n. So very often, I will not sum them. Okay, in the sense that I will use the Einstein's notation. So I will not indicate the summation, just to make my life simpler, okay? And here, this is the same as Aij, Uxi, Xj, I, j equals to 1 to n, equals to 0, okay? So Aij is not Axi, Xj. Aij is a matrix, okay? So what does it mean to say that A is elliptic? So this is the same as saying that the equation for the operator in 1 is elliptic. That means, or in this course of this lecture, I will only talk about uniform ellipticity, okay? Uniformly elliptic if there exists little lambda, capital lambda, both bigger than 0, such that the eigenvalues of A are bounded from above by capital lambda and from below by little lambda. Okay? So such that Aij, psi I, psi j is bigger than or equal to little lambda, psi square, and less than or equal to capital lambda square. So that means that when you apply this matrix, So this is a summation, all right, which I am not going to write every time. So you see that this ellipticity gives you a comparable norm. So on the right hand side, you always see the norm of the vector, right? So what ellipticity tells you is that it will shrink and expand certain directions, but eventually what you get is a comparable norm. Okay? So, all right. Now, in most of Professor Adimurthy's lectures, what you have encountered would be the divergence from counterpart, which is divergence of Ax grad u equals to 0. So, if you write it in this manner, this is simply Ti Aij Dj u equals to 0. Right? So, these are the kind of PDEs you would have encountered in these lectures. But you can always move from one form to the other, provided you are willing to dispense some lower order terms. Okay? And how do you do it? Because if you just take the derivative inside formally, you put the derivative onto this term. So the first term is Aij Dij u, or in my notation I should use this to be Uij just to be consistent, and then you take the second term is you take the derivative of this guy, right? Aij I plus Aij I, and then Uj is equal to 0. And this term constitutes, so if you sum over I, so write Bj equals to Aij, because you can sum in any order, right? So these are all Einstein's notations. Okay? So this is Aij I equals to 1 to n. So you see that you can go from one PDE to the other, right? Provided the coefficients are smooth. Or at least in this case, C1. So this is of the form Aij Uij plus Bj Uj equals to 0. Alright? So you can switch from one form to the other, but of course you need enough regularity of the coefficients. But for this moment, just assume everything is smooth. But the kind of information that we are going to derive in the course of lectures would not depend much on the smoothness. Okay? So whenever they do, I will be more specific. Okay? So now, so at least for the first segment of the lecture, I will only focus on the point-wise information, which is provided by this non-divergence equation. Okay? So let us try to understand what this equation means. So, understanding the solutions. Solutions to Aij, Uij equals to 0. Now, if you think of, if you look at this closely, this is nothing but, so what you do is that you write this matrix A, which is Aij, and you write the matrix B square U, which is all the, which is the Hessian or the second derivative. This quantity is simply trace of A square. So this is the same as trace of A B square U equals to 0. That equal to, for any matrix A, is the summation A Ei, Ei, where Ei is any basis, right? And it's independent of the choice of the basis. So now what I do is that I take a basis which diagonalizes d square u. That I can do, right? So take Ei such that d square u acting on Ei is equal to mi Ei. So I diagonalize, so in the first step, I diagonalize d square u. Okay? So m1 to mk are positive and mk plus 1 up to mn are non-positive or less than equal to 0. Okay, so let us do this, and then the trace of A B square U will be summation here A B square U EI then EI. Now at least I'm happy that I'm in a better shape. Okay, so I'm sorry for whatever happened, but at least I mean it's illuminating in a different way. Okay. So d square u, d square u ei is equal to mi ei, right? So this is equal to summation I equals to 1 to n mi a ei ei. Agreed? Because this term evaluates to mi ei and MI can be put out. Okay? Now let us try to, you know that this part is positive, right? By electricity. This is the norm of EI square, which is 1. Okay? So EI is an orthogonal basis. So norm of EI is equal to 1. Of course, this norm is not 1. All I am trying to say is that EI, this is comparable to the norm of EI square. Okay? So now, what I do is that I bifurcate the positive eigenvalues from the negative ones. So this is equal to summation I equals to 1 to k mi aei ei plus I equals to k plus 1 to n mi aei ei. Now, this part is positive, right? This part is positive, okay? And this is, and so what is the maximum value of this? By electricity, capital lambda, right? This is the maximum bound on the eigenvalue. So, the first part is less than equal to capital lambda mi, I equals to 1 to k. And now, what is the minimum bound on the eigenvalue? Little lambda. So, this is bigger than equal to little lambda I equals to 1 to k. Alright? So, you see that these are the bounds. And now these are negative, right? So, because it's negative, so you want to make it less negative, so you better use little lambda over here, right? So, this is less than equal to little lambda m. Why am I writing lambda I? So, let me just write lambda I, okay? A little lambda mi k plus 1 to n and is again something wrong? Okay, so let me just continue. Okay, so then I will. Now you want to suppose you how much maximum negative can it go? It is already negative, right? Because AEI EI is positive and MI is negative. So that will be contracted from below by the maximum eigenvalue of A, which is capital lambda. Of course, it's not the maximum eigenvalue of A, but it's the bound on the maximum eigenvalue of A. So, this is bounded from below by this negative number, which is capital lambda mi I equals to 1 to k plus 1 to n. Okay? So, now using this, let us try to bound trace of a b square u. What do you know about this? If u is a solution, this is 0, right? So, let us try to bound it from above and below. And what are these mi's? These mi's are the curvatures of u in a certain coordinates, right? These mi's, these are the diagonal elements of d square u, right? So, these are the curvatures of u in a certain coordinates, okay? Point by point, you change the coordinate so that Hessian becomes diagonal, okay? So, therefore, trace of a d square u, which is 0, because this is the equation, is less than equal to what? This is, the first part is less than equal to capital lambda times mi. So, this is less than equal to capital lambda times mi, where mi is bigger than 0 and little lambda times mi. So, the second part. So, what are you doing? You are segregating the sum into two parts, positive and the negative chunk. Okay. So, the positive chunk, first part, this is the bound from above. For the negative part, this is the bound from above, right? Which is plus little lambda. So, let me put this lambda, capital lambda outside and little lambda outside as well. Summation mi, where mi is less than 0. Similarly, from below, I have to just get rid of something. This is a wrong choice. So, lambda mi. Okay, anyway. So, let me just write it over here. Okay, and then again I will write on the other side. So, this is, so, use the bound from below. First sum, this, which is summation, lambda, now I understood what you meant. This is not EI, MI. Now I understood. Lambda, MI bigger than 0, plus capital lambda MI, now let me try to say what is the objective of this calculation. Okay, so before I go into any comparison principle, I want to understand the graph of the function. So what are these? These are the positive curvatures of the Hessian in a certain coordinate which makes it diagonal. So the thing is that suppose you have a graph of a function, okay, which is like a catenoid, okay, that is, it goes like this. On this side, so if you look at the tangent plane over here, you see that with respect to this tangent plane, this curvature is like concave, which is like negative curvature, and this part, if you, on this direction, it is convex. So this is the positive curvature of the graph, this is the negative curvature, okay. So of course, that's a good point. So suppose you have a function in several variables, it will have several curvatures, right? So for this function at this point, as long as it is a function, so you better remove this, but otherwise it's not even a function. So as long as you are in the safe regime, you see that at this point, for instance, this is a positive curvature along the y direction, okay? And along the x direction, this is a negative curvature, right? So with respect to this coordinate at this point, it is diagonalizable. So if you move from point to point, you have to choose a different frame, okay, which diagonalizes it. So whatever it is, this part constitutes d square u plus. So this is what I would mean by d square u plus, which is the positive part of the d square u, okay. That is all the positive curvatures. And this part would be understood by d square u minus. So let us rewrite everything again. So whenever you have a solution to this equation, which is the same as trace of A d square u equals to 0, okay? So therefore, what do we get? We get that on one side, trace of A d square u equals to 0. So let us replace it by 0 for a solution. This is less than equal to capital lambda times d square u plus, okay, plus little lambda, okay, times d square u minus, okay, and from below, this is less than equal to little lambda times d square u plus capital lambda times d square u minus. Well, this plus should appear here, otherwise it makes no sense, okay. So now, let us try to see what these two quantities, these two inequalities. So you have two inequalities, right, which I have clubbed into one. One is this inequality and the other is this inequality. Okay. So let me rewrite it separately. So you see that from the first inequality, which is this one, if you move this term to the other side, you get that capital lambda times d square u minus is less than equal to minus lambda times d square u plus. Okay. Now, this is not a good way of writing. So, what I would instead do is the other way. So, then I will replace it by little lambda of d square u plus minus capital lambda of d square u minus. Now, these are all the negative values, right? This first one. Now, these are all the negative values, right? So, if you want to consider the norm of the matrix, this minus has to be replaced by plus. Because mi's are negative, right? So, the norm will be what? Summation of mod mi. That is the equivalent norm, okay? So, this will be norm of d square u minus. So, what you are doing is that you are looking at all negative curvatures, and you are just looking at the sum of all those curvatures. And the norm is the absolute value of the sum of those curvatures, okay? Sum of the individual curvatures, okay? So, this is the norm of d square u minus. And this is the norm of, because this is already positive, this is the norm of d square u plus. Similarly, if you use the other inequality, what do you get? So, let me just try to make it positive, negative. So, this is minus norm of d square u minus, right? And similarly, and because probability. The second one, what you get is little lambda d square u minus is less than equal to capital lambda d square u plus. So what are these two inequalities saying? What do you know about lambda and capital lambda? They are all positive, right? So this inequality says that the positive curvatures are bounded from below, bounded from above by up to a constant by the negative curvatures of the graph of u, and likewise the second information. Let me repeat what I said because I forgot. Okay, so the first inequality tells you that the positive curvatures of the graph of u for a solution to an equation, suppose you know that aij uij equals to 0, then the positive curvatures of the graph of u is bounded from above by the negative curvatures of the graph of u up to a constant, which is capital lambda by little lambda. So that is an information which only depends on ellipticity, right? Because what is the ellipticity constant? The largest eigenvalue divided by the smallest eigenvalue, okay? Similarly, the second part says that the negative curvatures of the graph of u is bounded from above by the positive curvatures of the graph of u. So said differently, from these two, what you conclude is that the positive curvatures at every point is comparable to the negative curvatures at every point. Otherwise, you cannot have a solution. So that simply means that if you look at this old catenoid, you cannot make one portion too convex or the one portion a bit too concave. Because if you adjust the negative curvature over here, you have to make the proper adjustments to the positive curvature. Otherwise, it will fail to be a solution. So you see that in the case of Laplacian, the positive curvatures and the negative curvatures have to exactly match, because there the ellipticity constant is 1. Okay? But for any other elliptic PD, the scenario is not very different. Although you will miss that factor 1, but nevertheless, at every point, you cannot have that the graph is a bit too convex or a bit too concave. Okay? So it has to be more closer, or at least it has to resemble in properties that of an affine function. Okay? Of course, it would not be an affine function because this is not. But all I am trying to say is that the curvature should be well balanced at every point. And this example is what we call as a catenoid, and this is referred to as a minimal surface. Okay, so I will talk about it later on, which is to say that the mean curvature at every point is 0. So you already see that ellipticity has a lot to do with the geometry. Okay, so this is the geometric information that you carry from a solution to an equation. What does the solution, what does ellipticity tell you? That I could not even describe what a catenoid is now, because I will soon come back to that. Anyway, I made a big whoop up, so I have to compensate it. Okay, so I will come back to it. So, the other thing is that because, I mean, I am responsible for whatever mistakes happen, so I will probably compensate that by, so you have some afternoon tutorials, right? So, I will take some part of it, okay? And at least finish my agenda today. Otherwise, it would be quite an injustice, okay? So, this was my mistake, and I never, an unprecedented one, okay? So, anyway. If it has happened, it has happened. So, you see, so all I am trying to say is that whenever you have a graph, let's call it an object A. I just mentioned it as a catenoid, but I happily ignored it. I will come back to that. So, after I do comparison principle, I will soon come back to that, okay? I assure you. Okay, so you see, right now I am just trying to convey what ellipticity tells you. That is, whenever you have a solution to the elliptic equation, it means that the graph of the function has some special properties. That whatever negative curvatures it has to be equally balanced in some other directions by the positive curvatures. That is what ellipticity tells you. So, in that respect, it resembles certain properties of an affine function. Okay? But of course, you know that affine functions are not the only solutions, because that is not true even for the Laplacian, right? You have, for instance, the function, you can have any function where the two curvatures balance. For instance, if you take x square minus y square, you see that the positive part and the negative part balances. And I'm sure that it's a solution to Laplacian here, okay? So let's move on, because I have not even started what I supposed to, okay? But anyway, this excursion was important. First, we need to understand what electricity is, okay? At least for the next few minutes, try to be sympathetic, because anyway, I struggled a lot, right? So anyway, let me now state what is the comparison principle, okay? So what I would first do is that I will first describe a weaker version of the comparison principle. So the book of Evans call it by a certain name, so weak maximum principle. Or let me just call it weak comparison principle. So let me now, before I state this, let me also elaborate on this aspect a little more because I need it. So you see that whenever you have a sub-solution to an equation, which is to say that Aij, Uij is bigger than or equal to 0, so that would only mean that this side of the inequality would win, okay? And this side of the inequality would tell you that the positive curvatures dominate the negative curvatures, okay? So if you have a solution, sub-solution to an equation, which is to say that Aij, Uij is bigger than or equal to 0, so the positive part of the curvature has to win over the negative part of the curvature. Maybe they will balance, in which case it will be a solution, but at least this one-sided inequality tells you the positive part has to dominate the negative part up to some constant, okay? Positive part of the curvature has to dominate the negative part of the curvature. So similarly, so that means that the function should be more convex than concave, because for a sub-solution, the positive part has to dominate. Similarly, if you have Aij, Uij is less than or equal to 0, which would simply mean that the other sided inequality would win, okay? So, if it is less than or equal to 0, it means that this side will win, okay? So, sorry, the first side, this one would have won. So, for a sub-solution, this will be bigger than or equal to 0, so you can only utilize this inequality, which would tell you that the negative part, which is this, is controlled by the positive part. Okay? So that is for a sub-solution. So the function is more convex and less concave. For a super-solution, you will have that this side of the inequality would only be valid because you don't know about the other-sided one, and this will tell you that the positive part is controlled by the negative part. So for a super-solution, you should think that in more directions it is concave and in lesser directions it is convex. So for a solution, the two has to balance, okay? But for a sub-solution, you just have one-sided restriction on the curvature. That is, it should better be more convex, okay? So now let me state the comparison principle. And when I state it, if you use this heuristic, everything will appear more natural, okay? So now, suppose you have Aij, Uij is bigger than or equal to 0 in a domain omega, which is to say that it is a sub-solution to an equation. So I will ignore the lower order terms because it will not have much effect. But let me just tell you that this would be valid for Bi, Ui is bigger than or equal to 0. Which is to say that you sum over I equals to 1 to n over here, and here you sum over I and j. And I assume that Aij is uniformly elliptic. Okay? Eigenvalues are controlled from below and above. These are sloppy notations, but because we have talked about it a lot, so this would be clear by now. So now, suppose this happens in a domain omega, and now my claim is that then supremum of u in the domain is controlled by the supremum of u on the boundary. Okay? Now there is an analogous statement where you have cu, but in that case you have to replace u by u plus. So I will not touch that case because that would follow from whatever arguments we have. So the idea is to just describe a prototype where you can see some of the key ideas, okay, and not to generalize too much. Now, let me tell you why this is so natural. Because suppose you are in 1D, okay, so what is the sub-solution? There is just one curvature, right? It has to be convex. So for a convex function, can you imagine a situation where you have a maximum inside? Suppose your domain is always an interval, right? Because there is barely anything you have other than an interval, right? As long as it is connected. So, can you envision a situation where you can ever have a maximum inside? No, right? So this is not such an unnatural thing. So therefore, these comparison principles that we are doing over here is essentially analyzing the curvature properties of the graph. And we are going to infer from there, okay? So of course, here we have a proof in 1D, it's trivial. But here we still need some arguments, right? Because substitution does not mean it's necessarily convex. Because in certain directions, it can be more little concave, and then the picture is not so clear, right? So we need a more analytic justification for higher D. Is it clear? 1D is trivial. In higher D, the heuristics are similar, but it just requires a little bit justification, which is what we would do now. So this is the statement, alright? So for a super solution, what will you have? If you have Aij Uij plus Bi Ui is less than or equal to 0, so you can think of it as a concave function, then the minimum is achieved at the boundary, right? Which is to say that this would imply that minimum of U over omega is bigger than or equal to minimum of U over del omega. So the minimum is achieved at the boundary, okay? Well, why am I writing like this? So let me write infimum, or let me just avoid supremum, okay? So omega closure, so it's a bounded, so omega is bounded domain, so closure is compact, so the maximum is achieved at some point. So for a subsolution, the maximum is achieved at the boundary, okay? And for a super solution, the maximum, minimum is achieved at the boundary, okay? This is what it says. I mean, of course, you can have a minimum at an interior point, but in that case, it has to be right, okay? So we are going to do stronger versions a bit later, but this is the weaker version of the comparison principle under the uniform electricity assumption. Now, before I prove it, let me also try to say from energy considerations, this is also natural. One way to think of it is from the graph of the function, right? Where you analyze the curvature properties, which is what we did. The other way to think about it is from the energy. Because if you have divergence of Ax grad u equals to 0, as I said, you can rewrite it in non-divergence form, right? And this corresponds to the energy Ax grad u, right? Which is to say that how much oscillations the graph can have. So what this weak comparison principle tells you is that if you have two solutions, okay, if you have two solutions and if they go like this, these are two different solutions, this kind of a situation cannot happen. Why? Because by energy considerations, you see that if you go below, then go above, you will be spending too much of energy. It's more profitable to go like this. Okay? So from energy considerations, you see that the oscillations will be more minimized if you better travel like this. So this kind of a situation would not happen. Alright? So this is also in the heart of the weak comparison principle. Okay? So this is just the heuristic. Is it clear? From the picture it is, right? Because that is the way I drew it purposely. Huh? No, there is nothing much to get. It's just the intuition that if you have two graphs which are solutions to this equation, and suppose you know that at the boundary, one is bigger than the other. You know that the difference of two solutions is also a solution, right? A subsolution and a super solution. So you see that if one is bigger than the other in the boundary, it cannot happen that inside they have this kind of a intersection. Because if it goes below and then above, it would have been better to minimize this gradient. It would have been better for the first function, this function, to travel like this. Because here you spend less energy, right? But if you go down and then above, you end up spending more energy, okay? This is not a proof, but this is just a heuristic. So now let us prove it. So the first reduction will be, or the first case 1, which is the simpler one. Suppose I have that Aij Uij plus Bi Ui is bigger than 0, okay? At every point in the domain. So I assume a strict inequality, okay? Then I have to establish this. Why am I writing less than equal to? Okay, this is I mean, even the other side is correct, but all I'm trying to say is that there will be an equality, okay? So, now, suppose this does not happen. Suppose this is untrue, okay? Suppose, one, well, I call one too many things. So, this is one, this is two. So, suppose two is untrue. That means that there is an interior point where the maximum happens, right? Now, what are the conditions of maximum? You have to have, suppose x naught in omega interior is the maximum. Then you write the extrema conditions, right? At that point, you need to have that the tangent plane is horizontal, right? So at that point, you need to have that du of x naught is equal to 0. And you need to have that all the curvatures are negative, because the only way there is a maxima is that it will be like this, right? So, all the curvatures at that point is negative. I mean, it can even be zero, but all I am trying to say that it should at least be, at least all the ones should be non-positive. Okay? So, now you already see that for a sub-solution, this kind of a thing cannot happen, right? But of course, we need to prove it. You see what I mean? So, from here, you immediately read off that if at all there is a point of maxima, all the curvatures, so what a subsolution tells you is that almost all curvatures, so all the positive curvatures should dominate the negative curvatures, right? For a subsolution. And this one is telling that at the point of extrema, all the curvatures are negative. So, both cannot happen together, right? So, let us just supply a formal proof. So, what you do is the following. So, let me not go too much into linear algebra because I will be stating too many wrong facts, but hopefully this fact that I am going to say is probably true, okay? So, believe me that if A and B are positive or non-negative, okay, then trace of AB is bigger than or equal to 0. Okay, this is correct. This is certainly true. And the other thing, of course, from here you derive that if A is bigger than or equal to 0 and B is less than or equal to 0, this would imply that trace of AB is less than or equal to 0. Okay? So, let me call this 3 because this is this board doesn't erase properly. So, I better have to go over there. So, now what are my A and B? It's almost clear. A is Aij, right? And what is B? B is B square of u x naught. What do you know about this B? This is negative. So, what will my linear algebra say? Trace of AB will be less than or equal to 0. So, trace of A, d square u, which is the part of the equation, not the whole equation, Aij, uij will be less than or equal to 0. This part is less than or equal to 0. Also, from the gradient condition, what do I infer? What should this bi, ui be at the point x naught? So, all I am trying to do is that I am trying to compute this equation at x naught. So, at the point x naught, what is the value of bi, ui? 0, because all the derivatives are 0. So, bi, ui, so this is at x naught. And bi, ui is equal to 0 at x naught. So, if you couple the two, what you get is aij, uij plus bi, ui is less than or equal to 0 at x naught. Why? Because the first is less than or equal to 0, the second is 0. So, altogether, it is less than or equal to 0. And that will contradict the assumption that I have put in place. So, under the assumption that there is a strict inequality, you have a strict subsolution, you see that you reach a contradiction, right? So, the maximum better be achieved at the boundary. Clear? And now I have to justify why this assumption is a reasonable one. So, what I will do is that I will change u by some little quantity, which is the following. So, now what I have to do is remove the assumption in case 1. This is the second step. So, this should not have been called case 1. So, let me just call it assumption A. Okay? So, remove A. do is the following. You perturb this U. So you know that for a subsolution, the curvatures are non-negative, right? So it's better to perturb it by a convex function and have a strict inequality. And then make this perturbation go to zero. Okay? So is it clear? So all I would do is that, because it's a linear equation, given the graph, I will perturb it by something which is convex. So the sum is strictly convex. Okay? So that is what I will do is the following. I will choose this new function v, which is a nice convex function, which is the exponential one, e to the lambda x1. Okay? Now, what you do is that you calculate aij, bij. So, of course, first I have to calculate what is. So, aij, bij will be what? So, only the x1 part will contribute, right? So, v1 is lambda e to the lambda x1, and v2, v11 is lambda square e to the lambda x1. So, you already see a positive curvature, right? Lambda square. And this lambda will be made our friend. So, we want to perturb it enough so that because you have this compensation term, right? If there was no compensation term, you can be a lot more liberal with your choice of lambda. But because you need to make adjustments over here, you better perturb it at the right scale. Okay? So, this will be made clear. So, anyway. So, therefore, if you calculate, so what I will do is that I will define a function u1, which is u plus epsilon v of x. I should not call it u1. So, let me call it w. Okay? Now, I apply the equation to w. So, if I apply aij, wij, this will split, right? This will be aij, uij plus epsilon aij, bij. But for this v, only the v11 will contribute. There are no other derivatives, right? It's constant in all other directions. So, this will be what? This will be equal to, so I have to use a different quantity, so let me call it, because lambda is my ellipticity, right? Now, so far in the proof, let me just mention one thing. So far in the proof, we have not made use of strict ellipticity. We have just used the fact in the proof that aij is non-negative. We have not used the strict positivity so far. And the weak comparison principle, as I will indicate by an example, is untrue if you don't have strict ellipticity, okay? But, so it has to step in somewhere. In the first segment, it did not. But in order to realize this assumption, that will step in now, okay? So, I have to use a different quantity, so let me call it theta. So, this will be theta, this will be theta square. Okay? So, now if you evaluate this, so this will be this, okay? So, this is equal to aij, uij, whatever that is, plus epsilon times theta square v plus theta square v, yes. Okay? This is my aij, wij. Now, I compute the gradient term. So, bi, wi is equal to bi, bi, okay. So, I need to bound it from below. I'm sorry. So, okay. So, so this is equal to epsilon, okay, a11 theta square e theta x1, which is v. Now, what do I know about a11? It is positive, right? So, this is bounded from below by what? Little lambda, which is the ellipticity. So, this whole quantity is bigger than or equal to little lambda theta square. Now, biwi. Biwi is equal to bi ui, which I keep as it is, plus epsilon, then 1 theta will pop up, which is bi b1 theta, then b1 theta, then v. And then, so this whole thing would be, so only the b1 will contribute, right? Because only the first gradient survives. So, this is equal to epsilon theta b1 v. Clear? So, now what I will do is that I will add this and get another inequality. So, this is, okay. So, anyway, so this I J plus B I W I is big. So the first part is bigger than equal to this, right? It is bigger than equal to A I J U I J plus, so I will keep some gap and write epsilon little lambda theta square B. Then the second part is B I U I. So I will write B I U I over here. Clear? Why I am doing it? Because I know something about this quantity. It's a substitution. Plus the rest, which is this, which is plus epsilon. So this is epsilon epsilon B 1 theta B. Okay? Now this part is bigger than equal to 0. Why? Because U is given to be a substitution. So this is bigger than equal to, you pull out epsilon, and what is remaining inside? This is lambda theta squared plus V1 theta times V. Now what do you know about V? Is it positive or negative? It's strictly positive, right? And I just need to achieve my A. So at this point, what do you do? You assume that B are all bounded, are in L infinity. I should have put that in place, that B I's are in L infinity. Okay? So now you see that this theta, not lambda, this theta is your friend. You make this theta, you know that lambda is bigger than 0. You make this theta large enough so that lambda theta squared strictly dominates B1 theta. So if you take theta large, depending on lambda and B1, you will have that lambda theta squared plus B1 theta is strictly bigger than 0. So the whole product will be bigger than 0. So in conclusion, what you get is that Aij Wij plus Bi Wi is strictly bigger than 0. So then you have this assumption A, which is satisfied for W, and that will tell you that supremum of W over, or maximum of W over omega closure is the maximum of W over the boundary. Now, what is W? W is U plus epsilon Vx. Now, at this point, you let epsilon go to 0. And that will give you this conclusion. Is it clear? So, you perturb it. So, you perturb it enough so that you get good curvatures, and then you let that perturbation go to 0. Okay? So, suppose you have a graph which is not very good but close to being flat. You just perturb it so that you don't go above that much by something where the curvatures are good. Okay? So that you achieve the strict convexity. Okay? And that is served in this case by this choice of the function. Clear? So, this is weak comparison principle. Now, as a corollary of this weak comparison principle, what you have is the following. So, let me just keep the statement and remove the rest. So, this is the weak comparison principle, Aij, Ui. So, a substitution and supersolution. So, corollary is the following. Corollary, which is solution to the boundary value problem, which is Aij, Uij plus Bi, Ui equals to 0 and U is equal to G on the boundary on del omega, is unique. So, you have already looked at the solvability issue, right, by functional analysis. Now, is the question of uniqueness, and this is achieved from the weak comparison principle. Why? So, the proof is quite straightforward. So, suppose there are two solutions. So, let us call it, I have to call them by different names. So let me call it U1 and U2, because now I don't have the risk of taking derivatives, alright? Because I am just going to apply this weak comparison. So, generally U1 and U2 refer to the derivatives, but not over here. Suppose U1 and U2 are two solutions to one star. Okay, then what do you get? This implies that if you take W, which is U1 minus U2, solves what? Aij. So the difference of solution is also a solution, which is Aij Wij plus Bi Wi equals to 0 in omega. And what is the boundary value of W? 0, right? Because U1 and U2 have the same boundary value as G. So W is equal to 0 on del omega. So now W is a solution, hence a subsolution, right? So the maximum of W will be realized at the boundary. What is the maximum of W at the boundary? 0. It's also a super solution. So the minimum of W will also be realized at the boundary, which is also 0. So W has no other choice. It has to be flat. Okay? So it is 0. So this gives you uniqueness. So now I want to better this information that I get, which is to say that I want to prove a stronger version of this comparison principle. But before I do that, let me try to pictorially indicate what exactly is my objective. Okay? Yes, so if C is not equal to 0, then the C has to have a sign. So there, what you need is plus Cu is equal to 0, where C is non-negative. Non-positive. Okay, so then you get the same conclusion. Okay, but I am not going to touch that. Okay, of course, you know that when C is negative, then, if C is positive, this is not true. And this is something you have learned. So can anyone tell? So all I am trying to say is that because he raised this issue, let me just point out, because you have just recently done it, if C, so suppose you have a situation where you have Aij, suppose you take Laplacian U, plus Cu is equal to 0, where C is positive, then this conclusion is not true. Exactly. So you know that for the eigenvalue problems, one solution is 0, so then there are other non-trivial solutions. So you see that, of course, the conclusion cannot be true when the C has the wrong sign. But if C is less than or equal to 0, this is true. Okay? But I am not going, so my proof does not cover the case C less than or equal to 0. Okay? I just want to stick to this. At least for now. So what is the weak comparison principle? So if you, again, remember the graph. So suppose you have, so weak comparison is telling that if you have two solutions like this, okay, so this is just one cross-section of the whole domain, okay, which is one interval, some direction, okay, then the two cannot cross like this, because in order to minimize the energy, it better be like this. Now the next question, so this is weak comparison principle, okay. Now the next question is the following. Suppose you have two graphs which are like this, okay, which are solutions to the equation, can they have a tangential touch at this point? Suppose they are away at the boundary, can they touch at an interior point tangentially? Because here the energy considerations are no longer useful. Because it's not very apparent if you don't touch whether you substantially increase or lower the energy, right? So this has to be a consequence of a more point-wise phenomenon, which is the principle of strong comparison principle. So the strong comparison principle, which I'm going to state now, would rule out that tangential touch can ever happen. But that is a more point-wise information, and that is governed by the point-wise ellipticity, okay? And this would be the content of the rest of the lecture. So for that, what I need is a certain boundary version of what is called as the Hopf lemma. So I will state what is the Hopf lemma, which is the following. So suppose you have, suppose omega satisfies interior sphere condition at all points on the boundary. So I will explain as to what it means on del omega. So that means the following. So suppose you have a domain, okay, like this. What does it mean to say that it satisfies this interior sphere condition at all points on del omega? It means that if you take any point over here, you can always have a sphere inside which touches the boundary point at only this point, okay? Okay? So, interior sphere condition means that you can always move a sphere from inside so that it touches the boundary at exactly this point and at no other point. And it is strictly inside this domain. So, the inside of the sphere has to be inside the domain, and the boundary will only touch at this point, okay? you see that at this point, the two tangent planes are the same, right? And that can be justified by the maxima argument. Of course, there are many, right? So your exercise is to find me one sphere where you can touch it here. This cannot happen, okay? So now let me tell you that in situations when it can happen, okay? So for all nice enough smooth domains, the interior sphere condition is always satisfied. And the reason being, what does a C2 domain mean? So suppose omega is C2. What does it mean? So what is your understanding of a C2 domain? It means that domain is nice. Okay, so suppose this is the tangent plane. And so if you can write it as a graph. So what is the first derivative? Suppose you write it as x prime, phi of x prime. Can you tell me what is gradient of phi at this point if the tangent plane is horizontal? Zero, right? So it means that whenever the graph leaves, okay, the graph has to leave in a quadratic way, right? Because the first derivative is zero, so you see that if it has to lift up, so phi of x will be what? Phi of 0, suppose this point is 0, 0, phi of 0, which is 0, plus d phi, Taylor expansion, x, this is also 0, d phi 0, 0 is 0, plus d square phi, x, x, right, plus little o of order x cube. Clear? This is how the Taylor expansion is, right, for a smooth function. Well, I am taking C2, so this is enough, okay? So, this is what C2 means. So, this is bounded, right? This is 0. So, you see that this is a parabola, right? And the parabola is such that the curvatures of this parabola are bounded by the bounds on the Hessian of this phi, right? So, it means that if you take a steep enough parabola, it will always be inside the domain. So, this is your omega, okay? So, you can always find locally a steep enough parabola. It does not look like one, but it is, which is inside the domain. So, this is del omega. And this is a steep enough parabola which you can fit inside, okay? Whenever you can do that, you can always find the sphere which touches like this. For a parabola, it's a simple exercise to check that you can always touch it by a sphere because of the order. Clear? That's phi 0. So, it means that the first term, the first leading term at small scale is this quadratic part. And it is bounded from above by some c times mod x square, right? And this is order x cube. So, the whole thing is 2c times x cube, x square. So, now what you do is that you find an aperture of this parabola which is 3c. So, this will be bigger than this part, right? Which is the graph. So, you find a steep enough parabola and now you can fit a sphere inside. And this is the proof of interior sphere condition for a C2 domain. Clear? So, this assumption is not a bad assumption. As long as the domain is smooth, this is realized. But this is not realized for C1 domains. C1 domains, you cannot do this heuristic because there is no second order term, right? And the Hopf lemma that I am going to state is not even true for C1 domains. You need some C1. C2 is not needed, but you need some C1 plus some good modulus of continuity with a C1 alpha. But the proof that I will do will not work for C1 alpha. Okay? The proof I will do, it will only work for C2. So, the proof for the C1 alpha case is due to Yan Yan Lee and Louis Nirenberg, who are the giants of elliptic PD. So, Yan Yan Lee is your friend, right? So, now, so I have not even stated what the Hopf lemma is. So, this is the restriction on the domain that it satisfies the interior sphere condition. I could have taken C2, but I just want to be a bit more general, okay? Because you don't need, literally speaking, C2. Because even if you have a domain like this, it still satisfies the interior sphere condition because you can fit a sphere like this. The only problem that could have happened is if you take a domain like this. But if you take this kind of a sector, the interior sphere condition is still satisfied. So, I just want to keep it more general, okay? So, suppose omega satisfies the interior sphere condition at all points on del omega. So, and you will see that from my proof, all this will be local. So, you just keep locally around the point where you do this analysis, okay? Now, suppose you have, so let me draw this domain omega suppose you have that here, this is a part of the boundary, okay? And this is some inside. It could even be an unbounded domain because everything is local. So suppose you have that Aij, Uij plus Bi Ui is bigger than or equal to 0, which is to say that it's a subsolution. Okay? Now suppose at a boundary point, u of x naught is equal to 0. And u is strictly bigger than 0 over here. Okay? Then, so is it clear? So, this is in omega. I will write u of x naught equals to 0 at some x naught in del omega. Okay? And u is bigger than 0 inside. Okay? Then the claim is, if you compute the outward normal, so suppose this is mu, outward normal, suppose you compute the normal derivative of u at this point, this is strictly less than 0, where mu is outward normal at x naught. Okay? So, let me tell you that if you just wanted non-negative, you don't need an equation. The utility of the equation is to guarantee the strict negativity. Of course, the assumption is Aij same as before, less than equal to capital lambda and less than equal to capital lambda and bigger than equal to little lambda. Okay. So, let me tell you that if it is non-negative, it's obvious. Why? Because suppose if you take an interval, okay, this is positive here, it becomes 0 here. Okay. So, that means that if you compute the inward normal, which is just the this directional derivative, it is now positive, right? So, what is the outward derivative? Less than equal to 0. So, what this equation gives you is that it gives you an additional non-zero slope at this point, that it has to bend in a way so that the tangent is not 0. So, this is the additional information that you get from an equation. So, let me repeat. If you are insisting this, forget this. There is no need. It's just real analysis. So, the PDE comes when you insist strict negativity. So, let me prove it and then I will stop and then strong comparison will be done in the subsequent one. So, I will probably take the one from 2 to 3, okay, because or whenever it is. Okay. Okay. whenever it is, because I have not checked. Because anyway, I did not expect what I did today. I have to check. Okay, because I did not expect that I have to take another class too. Fill up the gaps. And that is not very desirable on Saturday, so I have to still do it, okay? Okay. No, I know I have two classes, so I will take one of the tutorials. Because what is the point of a tutorial if I have not educated you enough? Okay? So, let me just do something. Okay, so let me first prove it, okay? So, feel free to interject, okay? Because I will make many mistakes as I do, but also give me some time to recover. Okay? So what I do is the following. So suppose this is the point x naught, okay? I will just exaggerate my picture. This is my point x naught, where I know that u of x naught is 0. So, and I know that this is a domain which satisfies the interior sphere condition, which is to say that there is a sphere like this. Clear? It doesn't even look like a sphere, but it is one, okay? And then, once you have the sphere, so I will assume that the center is 0. Doesn't make a difference, right? Because if you translate, you rotate, you do anything, ellipticity does not change. The coefficients change, but ellipticity does not change, okay? So, this point is 0, okay? Now, what I do is that, I have to do the same trick that I did for the weak comparison. But here I have more information, I need some more information. So, what I do is, I just put another ball, half the radius, okay? So, suppose this radius is r, this radius is r by 2. And what I do is that I base my consideration on this domain. So, I will apply some kind of a weak comparison on this domain, okay? So, what do I know about u? I know that u is a subsolution, right? Aij. Uij plus Biu bigger than or equal to 0. So now my objective, okay, is to compare you with a super solution. Okay. So what I do is the following. So the comparison is like this. So suppose you have a line, okay, between two points. So a subsolution is like this, a super solution is like this. So you see that the super solution bounds the subsolution from above. Okay. So now I have to cook up a proper super solution to this. Okay. Now, look at this function. So this was one of the ingenious idea of E. Hoff in the 1930s. And the choice of the super solution that you have over here is not very obvious. We'll see why. So what you do is that if you look at the function e to the minus x squared, how does the function look like? At 0, it is 0. And at infinity, it goes to 0, right? And here, if you compute that, so what it has is, the graph looks like this. It is symmetric and it looks like this. So you see that for this graph, at this point, it is concave. And then, suddenly, at some point, there is an inflection. The curvature changes to convex, okay? So let us compute what happens. So what I do is that I multiply it with some theta, okay? And then see what is the inflection point corresponding to a given theta. So compute the first derivative. What is the first derivative? So first derivative is equal to minus 2 theta e to the minus theta x squared, right? What is the second derivative? Theta x. So if you compute the second derivative, it is equal to minus 2 theta e to the minus theta x squared, and then you will have another 2 theta minus 2 theta, which will make 2 minuses plus 4 theta squared. 4 theta squared x squared e to the minus theta squared x squared. So you want to understand for this new function where the second derivative changes sign. Okay? So you just equate it to 0. So this part being equated to 0, it simply means that you take e to the minus theta x squared outside, and inside is 4 theta squared x squared plus minus 2 theta. So when does the curvature change? So you equate it to 0, 4 theta square, x square equals to 2 theta, or this theta is theta, or x is, suppose on the positive side, x square is equal to 1 by 2 theta, right? Or x is equal to 1 by square root of 2 theta. So it means that as you take theta larger and larger, the point of inflection is more is realized at an earlier time. So if you travel the graph like this, if you take a large enough theta, the change in curvature is realized quicker and quicker. And why do I need it? Because here, although I know that there is an interior sphere condition, but the size of the sphere is not in my hands. It is given to me. So I better cook up a barrier where the change of inflection happens whenever I want. And that will be, and the theta that I will choose will be dictated by the size of the sphere that the theorem gives me. Okay? Now it is 11. So, let me still prove it. Okay? So, I can prove it in another 5 minutes. Okay? So now I have to cook up the right quantity. So, what I do is, so here the, so you see from this consideration that the right quantity to look at. So, you see that I will base my calculations over here, which is to say that I am avoiding this. So, on the graph, I am avoiding this part where it is concave. So, I am just focusing in the regime where it is bigger than or equal to this, okay? Which is, I will focus only in this regime where I have the curvatures that I want, okay? So, you see that e to the minus theta mod x squared in the region, these are all vague. In the region that I will be interested in, that is where the inflection happens, beyond that, this quantity is convex. Of course, it's convex in one variable, but I'm quite sure it's convex in because it's symmetric, right? Okay, so then I want to compare it with a super solution, right? I want to make it a super solution. So this will be put with a minus sign. And then what I will add. quantity that makes. So you see that u is 0 here, right? So I want to adjust my quantity so that it is also 0 over here. So for the maximum principle, what do you have? That if the super solution is bigger than or equal to the sub solution at the boundary, the same happens inside. Okay? Of course, I just proved it for sub solution, but if you take the difference, you can reduce it to the previous one. Clear? So I want a super solution which is 0 here and which dominates u inside. How do I choose? So I add e to the minus theta r square. This quantity you see, so if you look at this function, let's call it v, you see that this function v is 0 on this boundary. Why? Because this is e to the minus theta r square, this is e to the minus theta r square with a different sign. And inside, it is positive, right? Is it clear? Inside, it is positive. So, inside it is positive. Sorry, inside it's negative. What are we saying? So, of course, I have to bound it by negative. Inside it's negative. So, that's what I want. So, inside it is negative. Now, what am I given about u? So, u is positive here, right? Wait. Something is not correct the way I'm doing it. Oh, sorry. All the signs are wrong. U is less than 0, okay? U is less than 0 here. And then here what I will get is u is less than 0 here. So, here it's 0. So, u is bigger than 0. Okay? So, this picture is wrong. So, for a sub-solution, this is what I want. Okay? Now, this cannot happen because it's a sub-solution, right? So, sub-solution means what? The maximum is normally realized at the boundary. So, you see? So, by that consideration, so u is less than 0 here. So, the graph will touch from here. Okay? So, the outward normal would be 0, but the equation tells you that it's bigger than 0. Okay? So, this is the Hopf lemma. So, at this point, the normal derivative is bigger than 0. Clear? So then this is correct. Okay? So, u is less than 0. So, u is less than 0 means what? This is a compact set where u is less than 0, right? So, u is bounded. So, it means that in this region, over here, u is what? Is less than or equal to some minus k. Why? Because u cannot be 0 here and u is strictly negative here. So, u better be bounded from below by a negative constant because u is a continuous function. Clear? So, on a compact set, so you cannot have that there is an accumulation point where u becomes 0 here. It's a compact set. Clear? Inside the domain. So, therefore, it means that u is less than or equal to some minus k. So, I can always, and this quantity is equal to what? This at this set, which is, let me call it S1 and let me call it S2. At S1, V is equal to e to the minus theta r square minus e to the minus theta r square by 4. So, this is negative, right? So, now, if I shrink it well enough, so if I multiply V with epsilon V, I can shrink it well enough so that this quantity is bigger than or equal to minus k. Right? R is fixed. R is given. Where the exterior sphere condition happens. Okay? R is given to you. Point x naught, R is given. So, this quantity is what? Negative. So, I can always decrease the negativity by multiplying by some epsilon V. So, what do I have? So, I have that if I compare u and epsilon V, what is V here? V is 0. And what is u over here? So, at S2, what is u? U is less than 0. So this is the region. This is my omega where I am going to do the weak comparison, which is the sector. Okay? So, this is called ring. Annulus. Okay? So, this is my domain. This boundary, there are two boundaries, here and here. This boundary, you have that u is less than 0, right? What is the value of epsilon v in this region? 0. And at S1, which is the inner one, I have chosen my epsilon so that u 1 equal to epsilon V. Why? Because I choose epsilon so that epsilon times this quantity is bigger than or equal to minus k, and this is bigger than or equal to u. Clear? So this is my choice of epsilon. Okay? And yeah, and how is the theta going to be chosen? Theta is going to be chosen so that here the function, this function becomes convex. That is, after r by 2, the function theta becomes convex. Okay? So then I can apply the, so then I will have that this is a super solution. Clear? Why? Because this part is convex. Okay? So minus of this part is what? Concave. More concave means what? Super solution. Okay? So I will have, so my suitable choice of theta, which will be dictated by this r by 2, because I will only base my considerations after r by 2, which is to say that over here on the line, this is my r by 2. I just want to choose my theta so that beyond this, the inflection happens. Okay? Beyond this, the concavity changes to convexity. So on this one, because it's the minus of that, convexity will change to concavity. Okay? So I will have that if theta is large enough. So all I'm doing is that so I'm assuming that there are no lower order terms. Okay? Aij, uij is bigger than or equal to 0 and so on. So I will just assume that there are no bi's. Because if there are bi's, this will only contribute theta. So if you take the derivative, first derivative of this, this will be theta. Second derivative will be theta square. So theta square will dominate theta. The same philosophy as in the weak comparison principle. Okay? So this is, so the second order term is the dominant part. Because the first term will only contribute theta. So you will have theta square times little lambda. And from the first part, what will you have? You will have V1 theta. So now if theta square times lambda can be made large enough compared to V1 theta, if theta is large enough, right? Because the quadratic part will contribute lambda theta square, and the other part will contribute V1 theta. Now this can be made large enough if theta is chosen large enough depending on lambda and this V1. Okay, so that can be achieved. Convexity will be achieved, but you have to nullify. No, theta sufficiently large. What do you mean? I have to change curvature. Okay? So, anyway, if theta is chosen sufficiently, what you will have is that Aij epsilon Bij, okay, plus Bi epsilon Bi will be less than or equal to 0. So, this is epsilon B is a super solution, U is a subsolution, and U is less than V on both the boundaries. So what will the comparison principle say? That U is less than V inside. Okay? Epsilon V, not V. So, So I have to write here. So let me redraw this picture. Okay? So here is the situation. So here you have two vectors. Okay? So here you have two functions. One is U and other is epsilon V. This is sub, this is super, and this is S1, this is S2. You are doing the computation over here because this is super, because if theta is chosen sufficiently large. Okay? So the point of inflection changes. So then you know that at S1, which is this, at S1 you choose epsilon small enough so that epsilon V is bigger than or equal to U. And at S2, you will have that U is negative, right? Less than or equal to 0. So U is only 0 at this point, otherwise it's not negative, it's negative. And V is 0. So in either case, you will have that at S1, U is less than or equal to epsilon V. S2, U is less than or equal to epsilon V. For different reasons, okay? So then, by comparison, by V maximum principle, you will have that the subsolution inside will be dominated by the super solution. Okay, by weak comparison principle, you will have that U is less than equal to epsilon V in this annulus. So let me give it a name. So I have used omega, so let me call it U, which is this this annulus. Okay, in U. So let me now infer how do I get the conclusion from here. Okay, U is less than equal to epsilon V in U. So omega satisfies the exterior sphere condition. Let me just erase it, okay? Because this is clear from the context. So let me draw another picture, which is to say that, so this is the point x naught, this is the sphere, and this is another sphere, this is 0, okay? And U is less than equal to epsilon V, okay? In U. And you see that this is the direction of the normal to the tangent plane here, inward normal. Why is it so? Because these two surfaces touch at this point, so the tangent plane coincides. So the normal also has to coincide, because there is just one choice of the normal up to direction, up to sign. So the normal to the sphere is known. This is the radial vector. So for this, the normal is also at this point. Clear? So then, this is the inward normal, right? So let us do the computation for the inward normal, and the outward normal will just be the opposite of that. Okay? So here, what is the value of V? So here at this point x naught, you know that epsilon V x naught is equal to 0 and U of x naught is equal to 0, because U is assumed to be 0 here. And now from the weak comparison, so what you know is that if you move along this vector, along this direction, take some point x over here in the direction of the radial vector, you get that epsilon V x, because of weak comparison principle, is bigger than equal to U of x. Clear? And now you subtract from both U x 0 and this 0, because they are both 0. You subtract 0 from this inequality. Clear? So you can replace it by, now is it, now this is clear, right? Bigger than equal to U of x. Is it clear? Now I am going to subtract 0. Minus 0, minus 0. Except that I am going to use different representations for 0. Here I will use epsilon Vx0. Clear? And here I will use Ux0. And now I will divide by x minus x0. One side, okay? So x minus x0, okay? The norm of this. I want to divide by x minus x naught, okay? So, x minus x naught. Now, you see that when you take x minus x naught, the sign will be reversed, because, I am taking the directional derivative, right? So, x and x naught, so suppose this is Rn minus 1, after rotation I can achieve this, right? So, I am taking, so then, what is the normal direction? Xn direction, right? So, x minus x naught n will only differ in which? In the En direction, right? So, now the En magnitude of this point, okay, is bigger than the En magnitude of this point, right? Because this is the plane xn equals to 0. Clear? So, if I divide by, so this is xn minus x naught n, I can keep the same inequality. Xn minus x naught n. Clear? So this is the end. This is the direction. The difference quotient in the x n direction, right? And now, if you take the limit as x goes to x naught, this will give you the directional derivative in the normal direction, right? So this is the inward normal. Clear? This is the direction of the inward normal. So the outward normal would be the opposite of that. So, let us compute this value. This can be computed, because what is my function? The function is epsilon times e to the minus theta mod x square. So, what would be the inward normal? Inward normal would be, you take the derivative of this, and the normal vector is just the radial vector, which is x by mod x. Okay? So, the derivative of this is what? So, d of this is equal to epsilon 2 theta x and then e to the minus theta mod x square, right? Because minus 2 theta x will come. And then you, the normal, the inward normal, okay, of this vector, so let me call it w, okay? So del w by del minus mu will be equal to this quantity, which is, you pull this part out. So let me call it V, okay? So this is V times minus, and also epsilon, minus 2 theta x, okay? And then what? And then you take the inward normal, which is x by minus x by mod x. Okay? Then what do you get? You get mod x square by mod x, which is mod x. And what is mod x at the boundary? R. Right? So this quantity is equal to epsilon v 2 theta r at this point. Right? Clear? So this means that, well, so this means that u mu, I think I messed up the computation somewhere, so, where? Just let me, it's the minus of that, right? Okay, sorry, it's the minus of that. Because the function is this. It's the minus of that. So, okay, so fine, I get a minus here. Is it clear? Because the derivative of this term is 0. I get the minus, which is, so I get a minus over here. So, what does this give me? This gives me that del u by del minus u, which is simply minus del u by del mu, is less than equal to minus epsilon v 2 theta r at x naught. Okay? So then if you remove the minus, what you get is del u by del mu at x naught is bigger than equal to epsilon v 2 theta r. Now v is positive, epsilon is chosen, which only depends on the value of u in the inner circle. So this quantity is strictly positive. And this proves the claim. So using this, I will prove the strong comparison principle in the subsequent lecture, which is after 10 minutes. But I'm just sorry for this. So, yeah, thanks for connecting me. Otherwise, I would have been in trouble. But it has to work out, just that way. Is it clear that why this minus comes? Because d is evaluated on the minus of this function. Because the other part is just a constant. And here the minus. Okay, so I will continue from this. So this is the Hopf lemma. So the Hopf lemma says that if you have a subsolution which is 0 here, less than 0 here, so the normal derivative is non-degenerate. It is strictly bigger than 0. And that is because of the equation. Okay? Alright. Alright, so we adjourn now and meet at 11:30.